Yes, you reign victorious over all the earth. Let your kingdom come and your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. And to your renown, hear our hearts cry out, singing holy. God of glory, see your victory story in the lives of those who gather at the cross. Rock of ages, be adorned with praises as your people raise their voice in thanks and love. Let your kingdom come. And your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. And to your renown, hear our hearts cry out, singing, holy is the Lord. We're singing, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord, worthy of all praise. That's why we sing, all glory, all honor, all wisdom, strength, and power. All glory, all honor are yours alone forever. All glory, all honor, all wisdom, strength, and power.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all.
You can start. Good morning. Could you please stand up and join with us?
I sought the Lord, and He answered me and delivered me from every fear. Those who look on Him are radiant. They'll never be ashamed. They'll never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard me and saved me from my enemy. The Son of God surrounds His saints. He will deliver them. He will deliver them.
Magnify the Lord with me.
Come and toss His name together. Glorify the Lord with me.
Come and toss His name forever.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, blessed is he who hides in Him. Oh, feel the Lord. Oh, all you say, He'll give you everything. You lack no good thing.
Magnify.
Bless the Lord every day and night. Never ending praise. May our incense rise. Let us bless the Lord every day and night. Never ending praise. May our incense rise.
What a love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more,
stronger than darkness, our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are. On us, his blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, you every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more.
Yes.
Our sins, they are many. His mercy is
to the cross I look, to the cross I cling, of its suffering I do drink, of its work I do sing, on it my Savior. Gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. What a priceless gift. Undeserved life have I been given through Christ crucified. You called me out of death. You called me into life. Lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, holy surrendered. At the cross, you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm
your seat.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Susanna, and I would like to welcome you all here today. Either you are joining us in person or you are joining us online, you are very welcome in this community, church community, actually. It's so good to have you here, especially when so many church families are camping at the lake, and we miss them all. So again, welcome here. We also welcome our guest speaker. His name is Len Bachu. Len, welcome, who is going to share God's message with us today. We only have a couple of announcements. One of them is, unfortunately, there is no children's church available today. So kids are very welcome to grab activity sheets and utensils that are outside in the foyer, but I don't really see that many kids here. But sure enough, go and grab activity sheets as well as utensils by the steps outside and enjoy your activity. Graders or kids from grade 3 to 6, they are very welcome to hand in the sheet after for a prize draw. Lastly, we have Pastor Janen speaking at the Ranger Lake Bible Camp this upcoming week, and we were asked to pray for him. So please keep him in your prayers at home throughout the week. We will be moving to a time of prayer, and as I was reflecting on my week this past week, actually I received an email throughout the week. I was just living my regular life at work, and at my lunchtime I'm here and there checking my personal email. So I was checking my email, and I received an email that reminded me of my responsibilities and rights as a child of God. I was asked to read through the email and agree to abide by the community covenant. And that email stated this: to honor Christ, I will honor his name. I will honor his character, his church, and I will honor the mission of his kingdom by living a life that displays. And here it really made me think. I will live a life that displays honesty, honesty in every area of my life. Respect, including people and rules. Holiness in every aspect of my life. Righteousness, pursuing righteousness and truth in speech and deed. Humility, do nothing out of selfish ambition. Accountability, mine and others too. Participation, do my part as a member of the body. As I was reading kind of this statement, I realized that my heart and my mind completely agree what it was saying or what I was asked to do. And at the end, I realized this is not what I have to do. This is what I want to do. All of that are my desires. I want to pursue God and I want to pursue holy life so that my life brings glory to him because only he deserves it. And if we are living this way, we will get drawn closer to our Lord, and we will be more like him. So as we are now moving to a prayer, I would like to ask you, when I say, Lord, we need you, please respond, please show us your mercy. So when I say, Lord, we need you, you respond, please show us your mercy. Let's bow to a prayer. Lord God, your word proclaims how great and loving you are. We thank you and praise you for who you are and for what you have done for us. Lord, we need you. Please show us your mercy. Thank you for the fellowship you are inviting us to. Thank you for a fellowship we can have with one another as your church here on this earth because of you. Lord, we need you. Please show us your mercy. As we desire to know you more and experience you in our daily lives, we confess that we can't do it without you. Lord, we need you. Please show us your mercy. As your children, we want to honor you through honoring your name and honoring your character by our actions and words and in this pursuit. Lord, we need you. We thank you for the church camping weekend that is almost over, and ask you for your blessing and your protection on their way back. We also pray for Marilyn and Pastor Jaden as they serve at the Ranger Lake Bible Camp this upcoming week, so that they are guided and used by your Spirit in their ministry. Lord, we all need you. Please show us your mercy. At this time, we are opening our hearts and minds to you and to your word, so that they are transformed and more like yours. And because to honor you means to honor your church and the mission of your kingdom by living our daily life submissively to you, Lord, we confess we need you, Lord. Please show us your mercy. Amen.
The Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turned face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
You can stand with us.
Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders, ashamed.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name.
Song again.
I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like that. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, lifting holy hands in worship. We will not bow down to the gods of men. We will worship the God of Israel. You are holy. As for me and my house, we will serve you, Lord, lifting holy hands in worship. We will not bow down to the gods of men. We will worship the God of Israel. You are holy. You are holy, holy. There is no one else like you. We will not bow to the gods of men. We will not bow to the gods of men. We worship the God of Israel. We will not bow to the gods of men. We will not bow to the gods of man, worship the God of Israel, you are holy, holy, there is no one else like you. You are holy, holy, there is no one else like you.
Amen. You can take a seat.
That better? It used to be a time when you just needed the power of God, right? Turn me on. Oh, I want to bring you some greetings. My home church is Cornerstone Church in Saskatoon, and it is, of course, the home church of Pastor Dennis's grandchildren. So I bring greetings from them. On my way to church, I dropped my wife off at Cornerstone, and that's not a don't think that my wife not being here is because she doesn't approve of what I'm saying. But she hadn't been at Cornerstone for some time, and I saw someone going in, and she said, please give my greetings to the Bible Church. Do any of you remember Audrey Enns Nichols? Lillian Nickel was her mom's name. Anyway, she brings greetings, sends greetings. Where is that the camera back there? Okay, I'm going to, there, okay. So if I move around at all, will I go out of camera? Okay, I'll try to stick around close here. Susanna, thank you for greeting me so warmly when I was sitting at the back. And the kind of prayer that you prayed is referred to technically as a litany, you know, where someone at the front prays, and then the congregation responds. I was raised in a Romanian Orthodox church, and we did a lot of that. Only instead of saying, please, Lord, give us your mercy, we would say in Romanian, Doamne miluiește, Lord have mercy. So it's very similar. Now, it just seems like you're so far away from me. And, you know, had I more nerve, and more familiarity with you, I would invite you to come closer, but no, we won't do it. How many of you remember I preached here before? Anybody remember I was here? Yeah, thank you, Marilyn. I was much younger, wasn't I? And better looking, I'm pretty sure. But it was about a dozen years ago, and I came here and I preached for Pastor Dennis, and I also then did a walk through the Old Testament. And so some of you may remember walk through the Old Testament. I am not going to go through any of it anymore because I'm pretty sure I remember very little of it. Well, Rachel, that's it. Good. I can see it back there. Some of you are old enough to remember Salty the Singing Songbook. Remember that? You know, it became kind of the music, the soundtrack road trips with our children. And one of the songs that I remember, and I'm going to try and help you sing it with me, because when I start singing it, hopefully it will be close to what you remember. Are you ready? Heaven is a wonderful place filled with glory and grace. I'm going to see my Savior's face. Why? Because heaven is a wonderful place. I'm going to go there. And you know, it just keeps on going and going. So we're not going to keep on going, but rather, I just want to remind you that I'm going to talk about heaven. I have to confess, in my almost 40 years of pastoral ministry, aside from preaching at funerals, I've never done a sermon solely devoted to the topic of heaven. Oh, I refer to heaven. Just a week and a half ago, we buried Ike Rempel, and I talked about heaven. But until recently, it was about a year or so ago that I first preached this message, I haven't actually preached a full sermon about heaven. And I think because of my adopted theological family, which is Anabaptist, we practice what's called community hermeneutic, and that means that we believe that the Bible is best understood in context or in conversation, in community. And so I want us to have a conversation about heaven, and some of you are thinking, what is he doing here? We're not supposed to talk. I know that because I've been taught that since I was this high. But I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to pose a question. Here it is. What do you know about heaven? Not how do you get to heaven, not who's going to be in heaven. What do you know about heaven? Now, please don't tell me that the language of heaven is Low German, because I'm hoping there'll be some Low German speaking people there. But what do you know about heaven? Anyone? Oh, Dennis has taught you well to be silent, doesn't he? Did somebody say something over here? Beauty. Amen. Great. We're going to be exploring some of that. What else do you know about heaven that you've learned from the Bible? Oh, Jesus is there. In some ways, maybe that's the beginning and the end of the conversation. Jesus is there. Now, what I'm going to do is, as I speak, I'm going to make a couple of suggestions. I don't know if you're note takers, but I have an outline that I'm going to be putting on the slides. I'm going to suggest that you take notes. And then at the end, I'm going to be projecting my cell phone number, because I want us to be in conversation. I'm going to invite you to stand up or just sit and ask a question or text me. And I know, one of the popular things that is said is turn off your cell phone when you come into a gathering like this, but I'm going to ask you to turn your cell phone on so that if you want to text me, you can. But I believe, among other things, there are many misconceptions about heaven. And some of it even in the church. If you went out on the street and asked people what they know about heaven, some of them might joke about it. Or some, like the old Canadian rocker, David Clayton Thomas, might say something along the lines of, I know there ain't no heaven, but I pray there ain't no hell. There are misconceptions about heaven. But heaven is such an important topic that I think we need to talk about it. We need to focus our attention on what God has promised us. Now, when I preached this at Cornerstone, one of the applications for every sermon that I preach there is this. After the service, let's meet at Wendy's for lunch. And I know we can't go out to Wendy's for lunch, but that's part of what I think is important, that we get together. We spend time with each other as believers and followers of Jesus. Well, let's see here if I got this. Ah, there. We're working, Rachel. There. I want to talk about some misconceptions about heaven. Some people see heaven as an eternal Sunday morning worship service. Mark Twain, who many of you remember as the author of Tom Sawyer and the Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, wrote a little book called Letters from the Earth. And in this book, the premise is that there is a demon, a devil, that traveled to Earth, and he looked around to find out what people believed about heaven. He said that on Earth, very few people liked singing, and even fewer knew how to play musical instruments, and a small percentage of people ever wanted to do that. Yet heaven seemed to be, from what he understood from the people who were there, an eternal worship service with singing and harp playing. He also stated that very few people seemed to enjoy praying, yet heaven was almost described as a long, long, long prayer meeting, infinitely long. He said that for many, the happiest moment in the worship service is at the very end when the preacher finally proclaims the benediction and people are dismissed to leave. He went on to say that nothing that seemed to be enjoyed on earth had a place in heaven. Is that really what heaven is like? I hope not, because if that's what heaven is like, I'm not sure I want to go. You know what I mean? If that's all it is. But heaven is a promise. This is the first thing I want to say about what the Bible teaches. It is God's promise to anyone who loves and follows Jesus. But no promise is any better than the person who makes the promise, right? Amen? You can nod. It's no better than the person who makes it. So I'm going to ask you, I'm going to give you the names, or not names, but I'm going to give you some categories of people, and you just tell me whether you trust them or not. Are you ready? How about a banker? Do you trust bankers? Nobody trusts bankers. Oh. How about lawyers? Do you trust lawyers? Oh, not sure. Somebody once said that if you laid all the lawyers in the world head to foot, laid them down at the bottom of the ocean, you'd have a good start. How about pastors? I'm really hoping there'll be some people saying, yes, they trust their pastor. Do you trust pastors? Oh, good, good. How about television weather forecasters? My daughter used to be really afraid of winds. And every morning when she got up before she went to school, she'd check the weather. And the weather's going to be warm and sunny. But she would look at us very glumly and say, you know, Dad, it's not a promise. It's just a guess. How about your spouse? Shake your head. Come on. Nod. If you're with your spouse, nod. How about politicians? No, this is the first real reaction I got. No. Somebody once said about politicians, you know when they're lying because their lips are moving. Now, that's not true. I have met some politicians who are men and of integrity. So we have to ask if God has a history of making and keeping promises, right? Does he? God promised Abram when he was 75, and that's my age, by the way, 75, and his wife was 66, that he'd give him so many descendants that they couldn't be counted. And he would bless the whole world through his descendants. There was a little problem. A little problem. They were senior citizens. I was at Bethany Manor, oh, this is a few years ago, and I met this elderly couple, and introduced myself, and he said, my name's Abe. Oh, hi, Abe. And he said, this is my wife, Sarah. And I said, what? Are the two of you thinking of starting a family? You know, senior citizens do not start families, amen? When Sarah finally was pregnant, I'll bet you they were the oldest people in labor and delivery. I'm just guessing that. But I'm thinking they were the oldest people there. But God gave a guarantee to his promise and was covenant. And you know what happened? 25 years went by, and when Abram was 100 and his wife was 91, God gave them a son, laughing boy, Isaac. God is a good promise keeper. Amen? Amen. He's a good promise keeper. I'm going to mention just one promise of heaven, and it's here in 1 Peter. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. The first slide showed that picture of a book called The Heaven Promise by Scott McKnight. And if you don't have it, if it's not in the library, you need to agitate and get a copy of the book in the library. But Scott McKnight said this, one word outshines all others in helping us grab hold of the heaven. It is the word promise. Heaven is God's promise that he will accomplish what he has said, he will accomplish. Heaven is as secure as God's promises and as good as God's faithfulness and as gracious as God's love. Heaven is God's promise to us. Heaven isn't just a promise. It is God's promise. And it's rock solid. Covenant was God's guarantee to Abram that he would fulfill his promises. Now, did God give us any guarantees about the promises of heaven? Good question, right? I think there are at least two. The first one we find here in Ephesians. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. The word seal is the root of the modern Greek word for engagement ring. I kind of like that. My wife's name is Iona. July the 3rd, we celebrated 51 years. 51 years of marriage. So 52 years ago, I gave her an engagement ring that was both a guarantee and a promise that we would be married. When we believed in Jesus, the Bible says we received the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is God's promise and guarantee of heaven. And the second is the resurrection. Now, how could we possibly believe in the resurrection unless God had gone before us to do it, right? Can we believe it because God has done? Now, if I said to you, after the service, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to meet with as many people as want to, and we're going to stand right there by the cross, and I'm going to teach you how to fly with your own power. You know, your first question ought to be, so Len, can you fly? Good question, right? Can you fly? And I'd have to tell you, no, I can't. Would you be justified in believing that I could teach you how to fly? Douglas Adams, this rather sometimes silly author, said, it's easy to learn how to fly. Throw yourself at the floor and miss. Not quite sure what that means. The resurrection is a guarantee of heaven. And we see that a promise made to us in 1 Corinthians 15. If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. Now, this would be a place to expand, to spend time talking about why do we believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But I don't have the time. So let's just stop here and understand that what I'm saying is that the Holy Spirit and the resurrection are God's guarantees of heaven. And the next thing I want to say about heaven is that heaven is about God. Heaven is about God. Somebody said, Jesus is there. Yes, heaven is about God. Whatever else heaven is, whether it's pleasures or joys or perfect fellowship, it would be empty without the centrality of the presence of God. Heaven is the place that those who love God want to be. We want to be there. So if you want to be with God, can you think of any better place than having all the time necessary, eternity, to spend FaceTime, one-on-one. I'm not talking about cell phone FaceTime, but FaceTime with God, never to be interrupted. Now, I don't like using romantic kinds of illustrations to talk about our relationship with God, but it kind of fits here. I remember when I was dating Iona. We'd go on a date, and I'd drop her off, and I'd go home, and guess what I'd do? Pick up the phone and call her. And it just seemed as though, no matter how much time we spent together, it wasn't quite enough. We always enjoyed spending time together. Time would just fly. That's a dim shadow of what time in heaven will be like. In the last book of the Bible, in Revelation, it says this, I did not see a temple in the city because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. God will be the temple and the source of all light in heaven. Heaven is God's promise to all who love him, and it's about God. Anything else? Yes. I'm glad you asked if there's anything else. Heaven will be the utopia of pleasures. Listen to these words of magnificent promise from Psalm 16. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. If you spend any time with me, you'll discover that I enjoy reading C.S. Lewis. Right now, I have one granddaughter in Sudbury and a grandson and a granddaughter in Windsor, Nova Scotia. And once a week, I FaceTime them and I read to them from C.S. Lewis. We read the Chronicles of Narnia together. And I love this quotation. Listen to what Lewis has to say. If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is I was made for another world. There have been times when I think we do not desire heaven, but more often I find myself wondering whether in our heart of hearts, we have ever desired anything else. I think sometimes some of us have this secret fear that if we focus on the pleasures of heaven, we become pleasure-focused or become hedonistic. But we have to remember that there is joy in heaven. It kind of reminds me of an elderly gentleman who was once asked if it was okay to walk on the Sabbath, to go for a walk, because you're not supposed to work, and is walking work? And he thought about it and thought about it, and he said, yeah, just so long as you don't enjoy it. Where do we get that? Where do we get that idea that to be a Christian is to be glum and to be sour? An old friend of mine who just recently turned, I think it was 102, who'd been a pastor for many years, said to me, there are some people who look like they were born in crabapple season and weaned on pickle juice. Why? Why can we be like that? Now, we're designed to enjoy pleasure. I love the illustration that Scott McKnight uses in his book, The Heaven Promise. How many of you remember the first time you saw an ultrasound picture of your baby? You remember that? And you got a copy of it, and you came and you showed everybody, this is my baby. This is our baby. And you looked at it, and it just looked odd, didn't it? And you turned it upside down, and you switched it around. But then one day, that picture became a 3D living color full human being. Right? Do you remember that day? And what did you do with the picture? You threw it away, right? You didn't need it anymore. I have two grandsons live here in Saskatoon. Finn and Forrest. They're 6 and 3 years old. Every once in a while, like this past Friday, their mom and dad were both working the same hours, so they brought the boys down to spend some time with us. And when they come in, they kind of destroy the apartment. You know what I'm talking about? They bring the toys out, and it takes us a long time to put everything away. And on Friday, Forrest, the three-year-old, decided it was time for us to go to the playground. And so he went to the front closet and brought my sandals. And he brought them to me, and he said, Suze, which do you think I enjoy more? Looking at these old pictures that my daughter Laura had of those two boys before they were born, or having them come into my home and spend time with me, which do you think I enjoy more? Sometimes I think the pictures are better because... Not as much. No, you know what I mean. And everything we read about heaven, everything we sing about heaven, is like an ultrasound picture of what the reality is. What are the things you enjoy? What are the things you really like? About once a year, Iona bakes a coconut cream pie for me. It's about all my old arteries can handle, is once a year. I love those pies. Here's what else I love. I love walking in the ocean, just at the shore. And as the waves lap in, it reminds me that of the never-ending love of God. I love going in the mountains. This past May, we were in the mountains for the first time in a long time. Went to perform a wedding for my niece. And I look at the mountains, and it's like God is saying, hey, I've got it under control, Len. Don't worry. I love being married to Iona. I love being a dad. I love being a grandfather. And one of the most magnificent joys of life is on a June morning, sitting in our living room and looking out the window at the green of the park. And after we've eaten, to have Iona take our devotional book and reading it to me. And then we read together some other passages of scripture. And then we hold hands and pray. Every month at Cornerstone, we have a prayer calendar in which every day has the name of one of the people from our 55 club or 55 organization named. And by the way, just so you know, I was kind of hoping to see Tom and Marge Keller here this morning. They said that they were going to come, but we consider them part of Cornerstone. We will share them with you if you like. But when their names come up, I pray for them. We pray together. Each of us has a list of things that touch our hearts and brings us tremendous joy and pleasure. Now imagine if you could put a weight for each one of those things that you enjoy, and putting it on, you know, those old balances like this, you know, with the arms, and putting all your pleasures, your earthly pleasures on one, and discovering that all those added up are like a little mote of dust compared to the tons of pleasure that God will provide us in heaven. I told you I like C.S. Lewis, and there's this quotation from The Last Battle, the final book of the Chronicles of Narnia. And the children are fleeing from the Calmarines, and they come across a small stable that is really a gateway to heaven. It seems then, said Tyrion, smiling himself, that the stable seen from within and the stable seen from without are two different places. Yes, said the Lord Diggory. Its inside is bigger than its outside. Yes, said Queen Lucy. In our world, too, a stable once had something inside it that was bigger than the whole world. That's heaven. Incalculably bigger on the outside, on the inside, than it we could imagine from looking at it from the outside. There are some passages of scripture that get me excited about heaven. I'm going to read a couple of them, and if you don't get excited, I'm going to suggest you take your pulse, because you may not still be alive if this doesn't get you excited. 1 Corinthians 2, however, as it is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Now, if we were a little more Pentecostal, we might be tempted to do a little dance, get a little excited, and maybe shout a hallelujah or two. But in Ephesians, we read, at the end of chapter 2 is this beautiful benedictory prayer. Listen to it. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. I want to tell you that as I was working on this sermon, I lost a little sleep over it. Not because it was troubling me, but because I would find myself, as I was trying to sleep, thinking about heaven and feeling a homesickness for a home that I'd never seen. Again, C.S. Lewis has captured my sentiments, and again, it's from The Last Battle. He writes this, I have come home at last. This is my real country. I belong here. This is the land I have been looking for all my life, though I never knew it till now. Come further up. Come further in. The more I read about heaven, the more I realize I was made for heaven. One last point. Are you ready for it? Heaven will be, oh, one more. Heaven is an eternal global fellowship. I don't know if you have a ministry of small groups. Probably do, because most churches do. At Cornerstone, we have a pastor by the name of Austin Christensen, and Austin has responsibility for worship and connections, it's called, and that's small groups. And Austin is always plugging to get more people involved in small groups. And I was thinking, Austin isn't starting small groups. You know what he's doing? He's starting Outposts of Heaven. You ever thought about it that way? Outposts of Heaven. That's what heaven is like. People being together. I'm so glad that many of your people are at camp this week. That's an outpost of heaven. When you get together and enjoy fellowship around Jesus Christ. A couple of years ago, just before the pandemic, Iona and I went to Mexico, went to Puerto Vallarta, and there were 23 of us staying at the same hotel. And we'd worked that out so that we could, and we didn't all coincide our times, but there were a number of days when all 23 were there. And every meal, there was a different configuration of people at the various tables. We couldn't all sit at one table. There was never any tables big enough. But I thought, wow, this is like heaven, being together. I have three brothers. And a couple of weeks ago, we had a family reunion, all their families and ours, and we got together. And every time we get together, I am amazed at how heavenly, and I'm talking about this literally, how heavenly it all feels. Tony Campolo wrote a book called The Kingdom of God is a Party. And it is. When Jesus spoke about the kingdom of God, he often spoke about parties. Heaven is party time. I'm going to try this. I know it's going to be difficult for you. I'm going to say, heaven is, and I want you to respond by saying, party time. You know, some of you are, can you use your outside voices instead of your inside voices? You know, the voices you don't want your kids to hear or your grandkids. So heaven is, it is party time. I love the parable of the prodigal son. You know the story, the young man takes his share of his father's estate and he goes out and he squanders it, doing all those kinds of things that good Mennonite kids would never do, right? And then he comes to himself. I love that. He comes to himself and he goes back and he prepares this speech. He wants to talk dad into taking him back, not as a full son, but at least as a hired man. And you know the story, when he got to his dad, and there's this beautiful painting, this Rembrandt painting of the return of the prodigal. And if you don't have it, if you haven't seen it recently, you should take a look at it again. It is in St. Petersburg in the Hermitage. That's where it's housed. But it shows the picture of this father with his arms out like this and the son kneeling before him. And you remember what happened? As the son tried to give his speech, the dad said, no, 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 bring a robe for this stinky clothes this kid has on. Give him some sandals to put on his dirty feet. Bring him a ring and that calf that we've been saving for a party. I want you to go kill it. We are going to party. So when the son came back, what time was it? It was party time. Where was Jesus' first miracle? A wedding. Party time. And you remember what happened? The wine ran out. And it was embarrassing. It would have been embarrassing for the host to have the wine run out. And Mary, I think of her as a typical Jewish mother, sitting at the table. Nudging him. Do something. She'd never seen him do a miracle. He'd never done a miracle before. And she had no idea what he could do. And Jesus said, what is that to you, woman? Can I just kind of contemporize that and have, you know, Jesus might have said something like, Mom, quit it. And then what did he do? He ordered the servants to bring these great big containers of water. changed it into what? Welch's grape juice? No, no. He turned it into wine. And the host said, wow, you saved the best wine for the last. Why did he do it? Because he not just that he wanted to help him save face, but there was a party going on, and the wine was needed. So what time was it at that wedding? It was party time. In Revelation, we're told the kingdom of heaven is a wedding supper of the Lamb. How many have been to a wedding in the last couple of years? Just kind of nod your head. Good wedding? Did you have fun? I did. We had a wedding in Banff Springs Hotel. How about that? We had a great time there. It's party time. So I told you about my circle of friends. Isn't that big? There were only 23 of us at Puerto Vallarta. But in heaven, the party will include all people who know Jesus. And we will know each other. We will have warm, intimate relationships with everybody. And I thought about this for a while. I thought, who would I want to hang out with when I get to heaven? Jesus, of course. Yes, yes, we know that. But there are other people I'd like to hang out with when I go to heaven. And I want you to think about that, and I want you to tell me the names of some people. I thought, how many of you would be surprised if I said, I'd like to spend time with C.S. Lewis. Just hang out with him. Being an Anabaptist, I'd like to spend some time with Menno Simon. Just find out what life was like. I would like to spend time with that old reformer, Martin Luther. And part of my other background is Wesleyan. I'd like to spend time with John Wesley. Who would you like to spend some time with when you get to heaven? You're kind of looking forward to seeing this person. Help me out here. Come on. Paul. Wouldn't he be amazing? This guy. Anybody else? I'm going to tell Pastor Dennis you're not mentioning his name. It's going down in the book. Who would you want to spend time with? You know what my favorite letter in the New Testament is? Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians. Why? It is the most pastoral of all Paul's letters. It is Pastor Paul writing to a group of Christians that he had spent a brief amount of time with, maybe only 3 weeks, and then he wants to know how they're doing. He got kicked out of town. He got run out. At one point, he says, when I could stand it no longer, I sent Timothy to find out how you were doing. But his words at the end of the second chapter capture my feelings about the people that God has allowed me to minister to over the 40 years of ministry. Listen to what he says. For what is our hope, our joy, in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. Well, whenever you get a chance to spend time together, I want to encourage you to do that. You are planting outposts of heaven. Because that's what heaven, we go to Wendy's on 51st Street, and there's a couple of tables that we take up, and one time, the shift manager said, who are you people? You're here every Sunday, yeah? Pastor Len invites us to come. Oh, I'd like to meet him. So I thought maybe she was going to give me a discount. Yeah, because I am a Mennonite, and we're frugal people, aren't we? We don't spend money if we don't have to. She just wanted to meet me. She didn't want to give me any discount. I was looking for some, maybe a bit of commission. So spend time together. Talk about Christ together. Heaven is a rock-solid promise guaranteed by the giving of the Holy Spirit and by the resurrection. It's about God. It is a utopia of pleasure, and it is an eternal global fellowship. It is a party of inexpressible dimensions. Now, I told you I was going to do this. That's my phone. If you have any comments or questions, text me. Or if you feel bold enough to just shout out a question. Len, and Len will answer. Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for us. And then, please don't think that that means you don't have to, that you can't text me if you have some questions or comments. I would love to interact with you. And in fact, here's one of the ways you can interact with me if you want to. I blog, and Dennis is one of the people who reads my blog, or at least he receives a notification on theology. And there's, look at that. Somebody texted me. Len, your tie is really cool. Thank you for your I got that once. You have a cool tie. Someone thanked me for it. You're welcome. I'm going to pray for us and pray that the promise of heaven will be in your heart. I mentioned my blog. The last blog I did, it hasn't been posted yet, asking the question, what is the church? Before that, I blogged on what is a pastor? What does the Bible say about pastoral ministry? We looked at who is the Holy Spirit? What is the doctrine of Christ? Who is Christ? And we looked at the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. If you're interested in reading, I don't want to bother you, but give me your email address and I'll put you on my mailing list. Let me see here. Somebody, maybe that was just... Oh, somebody actually commented here. I like this. How surprised do you think we'll be when we see heaven, either by its nature or by who's there? Good question, isn't it? You know what? I have a feeling that we're going to get there and we're going to say, how did that person get there? And the answer, of course, is very simple, isn't it? The grace of God. And I heard somebody say this one time, the biggest surprise for me getting to heaven is that I'm there. Why am I there? The grace of God. And the grace of God extends to all people. Party time in heaven sounds exhausting. True, but tiring. A bit of rest with quiet waters have a certain appeal. Amen. But here's something to remember, too. You know, this old body of mine that is now 75 years old is no longer going to be 75 years old. A friend of mine died a while ago. I went to visit his widow, and I knelt by her chair to hold her hand and pray with her. And then I said to her, Rosella, since I'm down here, is there anything else that I can do? Because it takes a lot for me to get up again. Yes, I understand. And there will be time. I'm sure there'll be time. Whatever we need will be provided for us in heaven. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. God will provide for us whatever we need. And there's a sense in which I believe that heaven is going to be kind of personalized. It's going to be, God has sculpted it for me. And I may experience it a little bit differently than anybody else. But I will enjoy it forever and forever. How long? Forever and forever and forever. And when we get to heaven, what time is it? Party time. All right, let me pray, and then is the worship team coming up again? No, okay, then I will pronounce a benediction. May I pronounce a benediction? I am going to pronounce, it's not so much a benediction as it is a blessing, the blessing of the high priest, Aaron. It's what I do at the end of every sermon, and so I hope you'll allow me to do that. Pray with me, please. Father, thank you for heaven. It's nothing we deserve. It's nothing we've earned. By the grace of God, through the faith that you have given to us, we believe and we will spend eternity with you and with each other. We will be experiencing unbelievable joy. Joy that is only hinted at in this life. And now, may the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance unto you and give you peace, both now and forever and forever. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Are we dismissed now? Amen. And as Mark Twain said, this was the best part of worship services for some people. So if you're one of those, God bless you.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now.